Professor Morse, il mondo sta cambiando, stanno cambiando anche le regole dell'economia e della società. Che ruolo ha l'innovazione e l'imprenditorialità, specialmente per quanto riguarda il settore food, food and nutrition?
Well, first of all, I'm very happy to be with you today. And I want the audience to know that I am a faithful and steadfast consumer of Barilla pasta, which is made in the U.S. and is the top number one brand. This is my opinion, but there may be others. So what I like about this company and the meeting that you're having today is that you're looking at all aspects of food and nutrition, because there are so many opportunities for innovation throughout the supply chain in this important industry. In particular, it's important for the audience, I believe, to bear in mind that there are changes in consumption patterns all over the world. Much has changed since the Chinese invented pasta more than 3,000 years ago. And it's changing again rapidly. Consumer tastes, consumer awareness of what is in the products, and most importantly, my research is showing that consumers now are willing to change what they eat if they think it contributes to sustainability on the planet. There is an increase in tofu. There, people at least are thinking about what kind of tuna they're going to eat in Japanese sushi restaurants and in other places. Menus in leading restaurants point out that the products may or may not be sustainable. And farming technology is also changing. A greater demand for organic products and so on. What we're seeing in our focus groups in Spain, at Asadi Business School and other places, is that people are willing to vote every evening on what they eat based on its sustainability. Blogs are cropping up, and large groups of mothers, for example, are sharing information about what's best for their children. One company based in Austin, Texas, has aggregated more than 500,000 mothers and is continuously polling them for their views on what's the right thing to eat and what are some other good products to buy for their family. And that, that group of 500,000 is growing at 10% a month. So the world is changing fast in the way in which food is selected, prepared and consumed.
Lei ci sta dicendo che la spinta verso un'economia sostenibile è soprattutto frutto di una richiesta da parte dei consumatori, da parte della domanda. Le aziende e i manager, gli imprenditori, sono pronti a rapportarsi con un consumatore nuovo che ha esigenze diverse rispetto al passato?
Well, sometimes entrepreneurs are ahead of the market, and sometimes they're following the market. I teach my entrepreneurial students to spend at least 25% of their time talking to customers. Every day they should be in a restaurant if it involves food, they should be in the supermarkets, they should be seeing what people are eating, and they should be talking to them about what they care about the most. These trends are led by a few opinion leaders, and the key is to find those visionaries. Visionaries don't meet in the most fashionable places. You can't find them in the Galleria in Milano. They're going to be somewhere else. But think about the movement in northeastern Italy, slow food, which started as a combination of opinions between producers and consumers and now is known all over the world, at least in some circles. If you compare changes in consumption in northern India and southern India and in Pakistan before the floods, those changes indicate trends for all of South Asia, which is a huge market. I mention South Asia just as an example. Different parts of the United States have enormously different consumption patterns and different trends. You have to look at the micro markets to get an idea of major trends.
I nostri modelli di innovazione e di imprenditorialità funzionano anche nei paesi emergenti. Mi riferisco, per esempio, all'Africa, che sicuramente è il paese che rappresenta la nuova frontiera dello sviluppo del mondo.
So, the thing about innovation is it is very much a bottom-up process. And so innovation in Africa or Asia, South Asia, will follow a different route than in the so-called advanced countries, because the costs of production, the costs of distribution, and the disposable income is so different. So innovation starts at the bottom of the pyramid in China. I've done a lot of work in Pakistan, and for example, one of the earliest adopters of some very advanced technology in cell phones was Mobilink, before Europe. They have the ability to move fast, they're well organized, and so we've also seen innovation in food, we've seen innovation in farming methods. I know a company, for example, in Denmark called Danfoss, that operates an annual competition inside their company to promote innovation. A team from China in Danfoss won the competition a couple of years ago with a totally novel combination of products from off the shelf from Danfoss to serve a Chinese market. This would not have been possible 5 years ago, and it wouldn't have been possible without this bottom-up, market-driven approach. I believe we will see enormous changes in food and nutrition as people become much more health conscious. I've seen in New Zealand, for example, a rapid rise in omega-3 production. I've seen in Latin America some major shifts, not only the government-driven shift towards corn-based ethanol, but also other consumption patterns. So I think this is a decade of enormous change, and the way to find out about it is to be in touch with these early adopters, and it will always be an entrepreneur who captures the opportunity. It's very, very hard for large companies to innovate because it usually involves cannibalizing their own products. And so they are faced with the innovator's dilemma, and they can't build support for something totally new. There are exceptions. Nestle has 9 brands that that are very standardized around the world, but another several thousand brands are locally innovated. So they can be both an elephant and a gazelle. They have the wisdom of the elephant for some products and the speed of a gazelle for others.
In generale, l'innovazione che viene dalla base della piramide, quindi dai paesi emergenti, è anche sostenibile in termini sociali ed ambientali?
Yes. Well, I've been very disappointed to see India's reluctance in their new power plants to use the most modern scrubbers. So they're delivering pollution which is affecting the rest of the world at a time when, for a modest increased investment, they could avoid that. In China, the same way with coal-fired power plants. And the implications are global. 55% of the mercury in the atmosphere over Los Angeles comes from China. And of course, it's growing. So on the one hand, emerging markets have a not very attractive or admirable record for pollution and sustainability. On the other hand, I've seen some great innovations in Pakistan in consumer products, as I mentioned. I've seen some terrific innovations in other parts of Europe and in Latin America. So it's a mixed picture. In the next 10 years, it will be driven by mothers who are going to say enough is enough. And they won't buy from companies that are producing in China and using electric power, which is dirty. They're going to ask these questions in the same way that 10 years ago, Nike consumers asked what were the labor conditions in the factories in the emerging markets. This will come faster than people think. The current recession drives more awareness. So I've seen consumers in New York City being willing to pay $36 for a t-shirt instead of $10 because they know that it was produced with labor that was paid fairly.
Quindi possiamo dire che lei è ottimista?
I'm optimistic whenever the dignity and the common sense of the consumer drives the process, because by and large consumers are smart.
La ringrazio, professor Morse.